What's good? What's good? What's good? What's good? Vibeship TV, we in the building. You know what I'm saying? Got my man Lay like the chips in the building.
Yes, sir.
Got my man Brock in the building.
All day.
And yeah, I'm saying we got my man right here, the architect, building big infrastructure in the city. Let him introduce himself. You know what I'm saying? And we back. Technical difficulties. But we back online. So, you know what I mean? Let the people know. You know what I'm saying? A little bit about yourself real quick.
Yeah, my name is Taekwon Troxler. I'm owner and president of Troxler Tech Enterprises. We're a digital engineering firm headquartered in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Also got a satellite office in Detroit, Michigan. And we specialize in services of mechanical engineering, architectural, structural, plumbing, fire protection. We also do reality capture, augmented reality, and a little bit of everything that specializes in the construction industry.
Talk heavy on the pre-construction set.
Y'all already know, man. Y'all need to go subscribe to Vibeship TV right the fuck now.
You dig.
You know what I'm saying? Go subscribe right now. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to keep saying it to y'all because, man, we need some more subscribers, man.
For
we
real,
need y'all
man.
To tune in.
And y'all paying attention right now. I know y'all ain't, look, put it like this. I know you ain't subscribed because it's still red. So I need you to press that button and make it do what it do.
Right now.
You know what I'm saying?
Sure. Right now. You know what I'm saying? Go listen on Spotify. You know what I'm saying? But we about to turn it up real quick. You know what I'm saying? Album of the year coming out. Shout out to Hardo. You know what I'm saying? We're going to see that boy next week.
Oh, wait. We're going to say it's a mixtape. He said he got the album on the way.
Ooh.
Facts.
Ooh.
Facts.
Album on the
album
way.
Album on the way.
Facts.
He said the album on the way?
Facts.
Album on the way.
It's crazy.
I'm going to be ready for
it. Y'all ready?
No, for sure.
So we're going to turn it up real quick. Let's get it.
So my mom's house is like his mom's house. I opened up the blender to let the dog out. Ball out, go all out. Just pass the word just like you logged out. I could put the call out, get a nigga whacked. 1600 block, I put that on my back. Nigga relax, get up off my back. Doing all that talking, that'd get you clapped. He a rat, don't get no dap, I realize.
Uh-huh.
That this Big Mac, it don't come with Lil fries. I done trapped it with my heel gas. I love my shooters, but I'm missing Lil Nash. Come right here and get a real path. That ain't stepped on. Get you stepped on, so hey, your vest on. Gave my dog 20,000 when he was fresh home. I like a long time, so I won't be left long. I'm from uptown, but I'm at the Exxon. Yeah, sold him a brick McDonald's in the restroom. Yeah, crazy big hustle, Rango hustle, left to him. You'll run a rich nigga if you standing next to him. Me, all of this truancy, trends they ruin me. Supposed to be you and me, but let us break us apart. Ain't no hate on my heart, scraping away with a fork. Traveling day to the fourth. Yeah, my dog lost his mom, so my mom's house is like his mom's house. I opened up the blender to let the dog out. Pass the word and he'll get logged out. Yeah, I ran this bitch, now I could jog now. I flooded like the sink is clogged now. Flooded like the sink is clogged now. I opened up the blender to let the dog out.
Okay. What
week.
It is, man. Vibeship TV, we in the building, man. About to get this shit popping, man. So y'all know what it is, man. We getting into it. We got the architect in the building, man. You don't really meet too many, you know, black young entrepreneurs that do architect, sure, in the city. You know what I'm saying? This is very rare. I want y'all to get a lot of game, a lot of jewels in this. I want y'all to really tune in and get some, you know what I mean, some game on how his development, on how he came up. So let's rewind the tape for him a little bit on like how you got into you know, and before you got into the architect, what led you down this path?
Okay. I come from Wilkinsburg. I grew up in Wilkinsburg. My mom and dad, you know, they grew me up, right? Taught me right for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But my mom had me at a young age, so she was still in school. My dad was still, you know, doing what he wanted to do.
Right.
But still a man, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, so I kind of had to, you know, figure out what I wanted to do as a career on my own. So as a parent household, they put me in Penn Hills. So I went to Penn Hills during that middle school.
Okay.
Shout out to Penn.
Yeah, for sure. So I went to Penn Hills Middle School. I was real big in football. So I played all my years for Wilkinsburg Little League, played football for them, then transitioned to Penn Hills, played football for Penn Hills as well.
Gotcha.
So that was just what I wanted to do when I was a youngin', you know what I mean? So
mm-hmm.
I was just in the sports. I'm thinking like, okay, I'm going to be a good running back. I'm going to the NFL. So I never, ever knew about this career path I'm on right now or anything to do in the construction industry right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just always thought I was going to play sports and go to the league, you know? So it's the fast forward through there. I graduated from Penn Hills High School year 2014.
Gotcha.
And I ain't had the best grades. My grades was not the best, but passed enough to get a diploma.
It was enough for you to get passed?
Yeah,
what you're saying.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But not enough for me to go to school and actually play football.
Yeah, like the scholarships and all
right,
that.
Right, and move on, like, with my football career.
Okay.
You know, so I just kind of had to figure it out from there.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. So when I graduated from high school, I was more so just still working, just doing, like, little temp agency jobs at warehouses and stuff like that, just trying to figure it out. But then a year went past. I'm like, dang, like, what am I going to do with my life? You know, I'm not about to just keep.
I ain't trying to keep doing this.
Right, same right. Thing. Jumping around job from job, warehouse to warehouse.
Yeah,
right.
I was working for the Flag Force, like, you know.
Yeah, I already know that. I already know how they do. Yeah, man. And it's like, if you ain't with a company, the Flag Force is like the lowest tier for the fashion, bro.
Let's just say I quit the second day, bro. It ain't for me, bro.
I already know.
I got
so,
you.
Yeah, I more so had to figure out a career for myself. My dad, he was always in the construction industry. He was a carpenter.
Okay.
He got his good degree in carpentry. So he was you know, building houses, you know, for the last 20 years and remodeling bathrooms and things like that. So mm-hmm. I kind of looked up after him.
Yeah.
You know, as my role model, as you know, like I love construction. I love building stuff. When I was mm-hmm. younger, you know, shout out to my grandmother. She passed away, but she grew me up at a young age and we used
to sit
on the ground and build blocks and do little stuff like that. So yeah. I always knew I wanted to be in the construction industry.
Yeah.
But my dad told me, like, yeah, long term, this is not what you want to do.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's going to take a toll on your body.
Physically, it's going
right,
to hurt
right.
you.
Right, right. You're
going to warning signs.
Right, exactly. So he's telling me, like, you're going to want to retire at a young age. Mm. You know, stuff like that. So I'm like, okay, so what else can I do but still in the industry but not physically hands-on?
Yeah.
So I went to go visit a school, Pittsburgh Technical College. This is in Oakdale, PA.
Mm-hmm.
I know exactly what you're talking about. It used to be called PTI back in the day.
Right. Exactly. So I went to go visit them. Meanwhile, I'm living in Penn Hills at the time, so the commute to there is like an hour. So
yeah.
I went to go visit them. I liked the program. Something stuck out to me was architectural technology, and that was done, you know, building the 3D models of the physical structures before they're even built, and
mm-hmm.
just the CAD program as a whole. And I'm like, dang, like I never knew about this. Like, where was this stuff all my life? You know, that
right.
I've heard it was in my high school as a class, but nobody ever, you know, it was never presented to me.
They never pushed it on you
right,
how it needed
right,
to be.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, in high school.
You fell in love with it at that point in time?
Right. Yeah, I did. I
could tell the way you just said that. You was like, basically, like, yo, I never knew when you said that. I mean, you like, oh, this is what
early?
I wanted to do.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I was.
Real quick, too, let me ask you. When you came out of high school, I know you said at first you thought you wanted to go to the NFL.
Correct.
Was when you found out that, did it really hit you at that point that you wasn't probably going to go to the NFL because of it when you graduated with, you know, not the best grades? Is that when it hit you, or did you know, like, kind of like before you
like a little
graduated, before you walked? You know what
and
I mean?
Honestly, it didn't hit me until after I graduated, and there was like no more waking up and going to school. Like, I'm a real adult. I got to figure out my life.
Yeah, got you.
So just to rewind a little bit, like in high school, I was never, introduced to like CAD courses, and I've learned like nowadays, like when I talk to people that used to go to my school, they said that class was a part of school. You know, I always wanted to do that, but I was more so into like art. So I took like art one, art two, art three. So, I like to draw, So I always like to draw and stuff like that.
You
but as far as
like in you for
right, exactly. Exactly. Yeah,
it was already naturally stored in like drawing, building something. You already know you was like, how can I really bring this to my reality? Like,
seem right. Like it all molded in this place for referral.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. So just to fast forward to PTC at the time, I'm there with my mom and dad. We're there visiting the school. I'm looking at the program, stuff like that. I'm like, yeah, this is something I want to do, but the commute is like so far. Mm-hmm. So we sort of exploring other options that may be closer to our household. So that's when I found out about ITT Tech. And also Triangle Tech.
Gotcha.
So compared to them two schools, I went to go visit ITT. I mean Triangle Tech. Triangle Tech was on the north side. It was cool, but the school structure and just the building, the classrooms, it just seemed like too outdated for me.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So I kind of just shied away from that, and I chose to go to ITT Tech, to pursue like the architectural technology degree. So going through ITT Tech. I was going there for about, 10 months. During one of our breaks, I got like an email to my phone. I'm on the phone with one of my guys that actually goes to the school at the time.
Yeah.
He's like, yo, you see that email? I'm like, nah, what email? What's going on? They talking about closing the school down. We can't go back.
Damn.
I'm like, for real?
Yo, I just got started.
How much time did you have left?
So the program was 18 months. I was like,
you was already 10 months
like
in.
Like 10 to 12 months
That's
in.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I remember that too when they closed that. Because I knew a couple people that was going there too.
Damn.
And it was shocking because like I actually like heard it on the news because it was on the news. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. They just closed the doors and people came to the school and doors and locks were
They right. was doing that with a lot of like Stanford Browns, ITT Techs. Yeah. Right. Yeah. A lot of those type of schools, like even my school when I went to Kaplan, like for businesses, like those type of schools, I think it was something like with the student loans that they was getting out or something. Like they was overcharging people, like certain little things like that. I heard in the news with Stanford Brown, like you know what I'm saying. But yeah, I know that was probably a sickening process for you. Is like you was going through that. After that, like what's the next move for you?
Yeah, so that traumatizing, not really traumatizing, but that trial events was really like devastating to me as far as like my career path. On the time that I was going to take to get through school and finish school and things like that, you know. So I kind of had to figure it out. I didn't want to quit. Meanwhile, my guy on the phone, he's like, I can't go through another 18 months and 22 months or whatever the case may be because there was like a decision you could have made. You could have either deferred your loan and got the money back that you spent at ITT Tech that was going to refund your whole loan back. Or you can get that transferred to whatever school you decided to go to continue on your degree. Mm-hmm. And also they was going to take off whatever like the core classes was. So say like English and mathematics and trigonometry, just little classes like that already got credit for whatever school you wanted to choose on beyond that. Mm-hmm. So I always liked the PTC. You know, just like I said, the commute was just too long. So
that commute ain't no joke.
Right,
man.
Exactly.
I used to catch two buses, bro.
You already know the game.
Right. So just like, you know, I decided to go there. At first I was taking morning classes. I ain't gonna lie, I wasn't a real big morning person at the time.
Right.
So I was always late to class and stuff like that. And it didn't work out for me. It really didn't.
Right.
Basically, I transferred out of morning classes, and I started doing afternoon classes. So afternoon, I would start at like 4:30, 5 o'clock, and go until like 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. Mm. And I was doing that. So when I transferred to there, they only took a few of my classes, like I said, just the general education classes. So I really still had, you know, a full 22 months to go, which is 2 years of my degree.
Yeah.
You know, so... I'm going through the motions. I'm learning. I'm liking the classes. Everything's all good, but I'm not good personally because I'm not able to, you know, work full time and get the income I want to get and go to school because it's not like I'm on campus and I'm getting provided like a scholarship, mm-hmm. and they're paying for my meals, they're paying for this, they're paying for that.
That's on you.
Right. It's like I said, yeah, it's all on me. So I'm paying for gas to get there. And I'm doing all this. So I went through a couple of jobs, actually, you know, working. I mean, going to school at PTC at that time. And, like, you know, I was a lot of tenant at BMW. Mm-hmm. I worked at freaking Jeep dealership is a lot of tenant. Few little warehouse jobs in between. So it's like bouncing job to job, just trying to find like the balance in between work and going to school and actually being able to, you know, produce myself income to make sure I'm cool and personally and to make sure I still get my education at the end of the day.
So you can keep the ball rolling.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So my girlfriend at the time, also the mother of my child, she was really there for me. She was really there for me 1,000% because she was able to work, you know, full time. And able to let me get gas money when I need to get gas money and stuff like I was really broke. Like, I'm not gonna lie, it was really a struggle.
No, we didn't. I mean, that's what the vibe's about, bro. It's about being real.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You being real on that is like, yeah, I mean, them hard times build that character.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You just knew that you was never gonna go back.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that's usually the case.
You ain't seen no
way. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'll never be in these situations again. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But when you got out, you're like, oh, no, it's never going to happen again. Like, you know
right, exactly.
But I get it. So, you know what I'm saying? For sure.
Yeah, I shout out to her. You know, she was definitely there for me. She let her, because at the time, too, I had an Impala SS. One day, driving back from school, my whole transmission went out.
Woo. Lord God, have mercy.
Now I don't got no cord.
Yeah, because once your training goes, it's like,
that's like $3,000 to replace.
Yeah, right, exactly.
It's retarded.
For an SS, though.
You know, back.
Yeah.
So, my training went out, so I was borrowing my either my mom or my dad's car, also my girlfriend's car at the time. So whatever works best for me. I got the money loaned to me to get my transmission fixed. So I actually got back on the road. So just going through just PTC, schooling, everything was going good. But I did end up, you know, failing a class. This class was like, it was like mechanical engineering. The teacher, he was pretty cool, but just the curriculum and the way he was teaching and stuff like that, I just wasn't adapting to it. So I failed out that class. You had to get either a C or above to get to your next course mm-hmm. of classes for like the next semester.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up getting a D for that class, and you know that pushed me back 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, three months to get my degree. So just going fast forward again, like going through the next semester. I was like on top of my stuff, like I wasn't, you know,
no games,
like playing around. So
that was like a wake up call for you.
Yeah, it was. So I ended up being the most outstanding student of my class for that semester.
Mm.
The next semester after that, so I'm like, yeah, that was a wake up call. So fast forward through there, like 3 months prior to you getting your degree, you have to go through like an internship process. So the last 3 months is your internship.
Okay, like who you're going to transition end up being with, type of ordeal?
Exactly. Okay. So we had like a career fair prior to everybody get their internship. And you know, everybody's talking about, yeah, I'm gonna go work for them. But they're telling me like their wages that they're trying to pay. And I'm like, no, I don't want that. Like for this type of degree, for what I'm going to school for, I don't want to get paid $10 to $12 an hour from an internship,
right.
So I start fishing around like on my own, like on LinkedIn, on Indeed, actually applying.
When the hustle came in.
Applying myself.
Yeah, I'm a fan of myself.
Right,
yeah.
You know they had jobs already lined up for you to go grab and take, you know, with no problem. But
you was like, them resources is cool, but they ain't where I need them to be.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. So I came across a firm that was hiring for electrical designer. Meanwhile, my degree that I got is a associate's degree in architectural technology. But throughout the courses, they talk about architectural, structural, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, fire protection, civil engineering. But this is all not necessarily on the engineering side and learn like the coding and stuff like that. This is more so on the technology side. So learning how to use the CAD program in order to design these structures before they're built.
Okay.
So I came across a job with Jacobs Engineering as electrical designer.
Mm.
So I got an interview for that and ended up getting the job, you know, for my internship. And they was paying like $12 to $14 more than what they was offering. So instead of getting 10 to 12, I'm already making $22 to $24 an hour
for an
internship.
Yeah, getting that motherfucking right. money, like going hard.
Right.
But you applied, that's the thing, bro. It's like most people would have been like, that's what I'm learning. It's like most people that ain't get to the success is the ones that don't apply or initiate themselves before shit start jumping off for them.
Right.
It's like, you might get an opportunity where somebody say, this is what you could do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But it's up to you, to go get it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And the reason why I'm saying this is because I was just listening to this man named Jim Rohn that said the realest thing, and I was like, and it was in the Bible, it was like about the three men. I ain't trying to get biblical on nobody, but.
Three wise men.
You know what I'm saying? The three wise men. He gave everybody some money, and only like two of them went to go make some more money, but mm-hmm. the other one went to go hid the money. Mm-hmm. And he was like, no, I'll give you money to do, because, you know what I'm saying? You ain't trying to go out here and go get it.
Right.
Everybody else took the risk. You know what I'm saying? That's taking the initiative. People got to go get it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, you already got your cards laid out, but you just was like, no, bro, I'm about to go figure it out.
Right.
I need a new deck.
I need to go.
I need a new deck.
This deck is cool. But I need this deck over here.
Yeah, I need this
fresh, brand new deck. That y'all was already playing with. I don't need that one.
Yeah, and I'm hitting hunting for what I want.
I can definitely feel that too, man, because that's how I was too. Like, when I first got into the workforce period, I graduated from Penn Hills too, but I came out in 2004.
Okay.
But now I'm actually a carpenter roofer. So, but I always say this, I wish if I would have knew then what I know now, I would have been in a trade, you know what I mean?
And right.
I'd probably been kind of better off financially. But yeah, like you said, man, for you to actually not accept the jobs that they were giving you.
Mm-hmm.
And even when I was at Kaplan, you know what I'm saying? When I was going for my degree, because I was going for mm-hmm. a business degree, that's what they was pushing on people, when they was doing their internship. Oh, get this job, you know? And it was they were promoting you're guaranteed. It's an 80% chance that mm-hmm. you'll get placed. But mm-hmm. they ain't telling you, well, it's damn near making minimum wage.
But the pay raise won't be and everything.
Be terrible.
Right.
So, but like I said, I can, I definitely feel you when you said you had to look on your own. You know what I mean? You ain't want to be in that predicament, bro. So
exactly.
Yeah. That's what opened up that door of opportunity right there.
Facts. You know what that sound like, too? All right, let's say you go to McDonald's, you feel me? I don't know if anybody do or don't eat. We just going, an example, just an example. Oh, yeah, but I'm saying, even as a kid, just think about this.
Yeah.
You go to McDonald's, you want fries. I don't want those fries. I want fresh fries.
Right.
I need mm-hmm. the ones with no salt on it, so I can put my own salt on my fries.
Mm-hmm.
You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah, no salt, they got to drop them already.
They got to drop them, bro.
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm saying? And that's what you wanted. You was like, all right, these is cool. They salty already, but these ain't hot like I want them to be hot.
Yeah, they definitely wasn't fresh.
Bro, they not fresh enough. You know what I'm saying?
That fits you.
Facts. So it's just like you didn't want the delayed resources, per se. You know what I mean? Like, all right, y'all got these resources. These is cool and all. They beneficial, but I just found my own, and I'm going to be eating for good for a minute. You know what I mean?
Right.
It make a big difference because you ain't got to – I'm not saying that you don't got to strategize better, but it made you strategize better once you heard what requirements and what stuff that you was getting from it, the benefits. Mm-hmm. You was like, this benefits is cool, but
mm-hmm.
like you said, I already went through this with the warehouses and the other jobs. why do I want that? This is not what I went to school for.
Exactly. Yeah,
right. Facts, bro.
Exactly.
So,
yeah. Like that experience gave you the opportunity to see what was ahead.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? That's what's up, though. But it's like, you know what I mean, getting in position and just executing, that's the key to success right there to me is like, because that's when people determines on who's going to make it or who's not going to make it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know what I'm saying? The person, guess what, is storming outside. Two men wake up. They're both salesmen. One salesman say, nah, bro, I ain't going outside to make no sales today. The other one say, it's an opportunity. Everybody's at home. Might as well go make some sales.
Nice.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Right. It's like, yeah, I mean, two different motherfuckers thinking two different ways. Opportunity took advantage, right on point.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But
you did something that they still don't tell, most people, you know what I'm saying, to do kind of do your own legwork, you know mm-hmm. what I mean?
Yeah, that's the problem. People don't like to take the initiative sometimes. Yeah. Like, people like what's given to them and not exploring, what else is out there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the school is going have resources for you, but they're not going to, let you to tell you to go explore other resources because they're trying to keep the relationship with the companies they already got mm-hmm. in place.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So they're not going to say, hey, there's five other companies out there that may want you too. You know, because they want to keep this relationship going on with these companies they already got in place so they can, have that internship type of cycle going with the school and the company.
You know, they want to create workers.
Right, right. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You
know what
I'm, but you knew, like, I ain't no worker. I just need the experience. Right. Give me the experience of what I need to know. So when you got into this place of this position, your next move was what?
Yeah, so my position was electrical designer, which was at Jacobs Engineering at the time, was the number one engineering firm in the world. We can look this up right now. It's on the N500. The number one engineering firm in the world, Jacobs Engineering. They got offices in every state of the United States and also in other countries as well. So it's like over like 10,000 employees, like worldwide. So my role there was pretty well. Like everything was going pretty good. I was learning. The main project I worked on was semiconductor plants and data centers. Mm. So I did like a lot of lighting design, a lot of running like underground conduit. Mm. A lot of lighting controls and things like that. So it was like a great learning experience for me on the electrical side. So I was working there for about like a year and a half. I got my yearly increase. Let me rewind a little bit. So I also working there, they sent me to travel. So I was actually traveling to Detroit at the time. We was working for a big company out there. Which was Dow. They was building like a new chemical plant, and it was my job to go out there and get like the resources of the equipment. They was moving from the one building to the next building, so they was renovating, you know, this building, but they didn't want to expense their equipment. So they're like a chemical plant, so they got a whole like bunch of different type of equipment, you know.
Yeah, it's crazy, different types of equipment.
And all these different types of equipment got different power requirements and things like that. A different outlet. So some outlets were like three prongs, some outlets were two prongs, some had like twist locks and things like that. So it was my job to go out there and basically jot on an Excel spreadsheet like, hey, this this oven that does this has this type of power cord. So when we go design out the new building and we do like the layout, we know where to put the different type of outlets at for that type of piece of equipment to go there. Mm. You know, so I was there. I was out there actually for 4 weeks straight. So I would fly out Sunday night. I would get there Sunday morning. I would get there Sunday night, and I would be there from Monday to Friday. I'll fly Friday, you know, have fun with my boys on the weekend, do whatever, and fly right back on Sunday. I was doing that 4 weeks straight. You know, they gave me a company credit card. So my flight was free. Rental car free, food free.
Swipe.
I'm like, oh, this is corporate, huh?
Check, please.
Yeah. So
it's on my company to worry about.
We're good.
Yeah. So my time at Jacobs Engineering was very great for me as far as experience. And so like I said, I made it past my yearly increase and things like that. But it was, my increase was like 2.5 or like 3%, like or something like that. It wasn't major. It was like a dollar and some change or something like that. You know what I mean? Yeah.
He said, they're giving me crumbs? What's going on? I'm not with this shit. Like, hold on.
Giving you that crumbly credit card. Was, you know,
I'm working hard as hell.
You like 3%, he'd be all right. He got that card.
And then 3% on top of inflation. That's basically like 1% for
right, right, exactly.
Like, at least gave me 10%. Yeah. Like, they just broke bread too. Come on, bro. That's when your mind start going. See, this is where that same intuition came back into play. Yeah. So he took the initiative the first time. Mm-hmm. This time, you hear the story. He's saying, "No, the 2% ain't gonna be working. I gotta find other resources other way."
Right.
What happened next, bro?
So from there, I started exploring like other employment opportunities. So I looked at like a BIM manager role. So my role was electrical designer. That role is solely for the electrical discipline.
Okay.
So I wasn't doing anything architectural, structural, or any other disciplines at the time. It was just solely electrical. So a BIM manager role, basically manages every single discipline from architectural to structural, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, fire protection, civil site, and he manages that all them disciplines on the technology side.
That's crazy.
So just to give a background on what a BIM manager is. On a pre-construction side, every building gets built virtually in 3D.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so when the building gets built in 3D, every discipline, every office has like their own
people or their own CAD people who's actually built in the models for the architectural, structural, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, fabric protection, and
right.
so on.
Right. You now, let me ask you real quick. Is that, are you using augmented reality when you do that?
No. At this point, we're just using, the industry standard right now is using Revit. Okay. So Revit's software that's that comes from Autodesk. So Autodesk makes the software. So mm-hmm. they have like this big collection of Revit and Civil 3D, AutoCAD, you know, things like that.
Gotcha.
And so the augmented reality and virtual reality don't come in at the time yet.
Gotcha.
So the BIM manager basically makes sure the model's getting put together correctly. All the standards are on board. Make sure everybody's playing their roles, making sure that the model doesn't break, because these models get real big. You know what I mean? A model can get like 50, 60 gigabytes. I'm not sure if you guys are like technical guys, but that's like a lot of gigabytes.
It's a decent, it's
a whole one file. And so it's like, it's that's his crazy. Job.
Just one to, file, one project.
Right.
Wow, yeah.
So yeah, it's his job basically to keep on top of all the team players and make sure everybody's doing their job correctly.
Gotcha.
Mm. So I found a BIM manager role at Michael Baker International.
Baker International, okay.
Yeah, so they're located in Moontown. So they got a couple of other offices throughout the United States as well.
Mm.
They're like a top 10 engineering firm. They're more based on the civil side, but I came in on more so on the architectural side.
Okay.
But like I said, in this role, it's not just architectural, it's basically managing, you know, all disciplines. So I come on this role. Their main clients is like government clients and things like that.
That's
so
the money, I can't, money though with yeah, government clients.
Right. And
that's consistent money rolling in at all times.
Right. So instead of going through my yearly increase at Jacobs Engineering and getting that 2%, when I moved to Michael Baker, I got like a $15,000 raise instead of the dollar.
You know?
So I went from making $40,000 a year to say like 55, 56 grand a year. You know what I mean? So that's kinda
usually what the average American that's making good money. Right. Like 56,000, like 100. Is that 100, like 100,000, or are they making around 50,000?
Type town.
Yeah, like 55, 60,000 a year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's weird. No, I'm just saying, because like, I always hear that, like with other entrepreneurs, they were like, the average American be making about 60,000.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I'm saying?
But it's like, to make that money here, though, it's like,
it's that taxes, though.
It's
after
the taxes,
that.
Right.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, yeah, you're still going to make your money, though.
If you got, if you're single,
you don't got no kids.
You ain't got no kids. Or even if you're married, we used to call them dinks. Yeah. Double income, no kids. You making, and your, okay, and your wife or your girl's making similarly the same amount of money, I'm making pretty good money.
Yeah. Right.
Because it's only y'all two.
That's six figures.
That's six figures, facts.
Right.
Got you.
Yeah, so I transferred into my role at Michael Baker International around that time. That's when my daughter was born. So it was like a more of like a relief stress for me. Like, hey, like, I'm making more money. I'm the one that bought me a new car. Not saying I'm telling guys to, as soon as you make some money, go buy a new car. Right. Like, no.
You're
like,
you
but
do.
You put yourself in a position, though.
Yeah, I more so bought me a brand new car at the time because I was still, you know, driving hoopties and stuff was breaking
it was
down.
So, for you.
Yeah. So I more wanted like a reliable vehicle in order to me, you know, to get to transportation back and home from work.
Right.
You know, so working at Michael Baker was pretty cool. But I did go to some issues with some of the staff members. I don't really want to just say too much, but just say
was it a big R?
Yeah, it wasn't a very diverse company.
Say less.
So more so, I came in at that role, you know, making the money I was making, and people that was already working there wanted that role that I came in on the outset.
Yeah, you know, you had the intelligence.
So they were sideline hating, basically.
Yeah, right.
Because you had the intelligence, you overall worked them.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I forget where we come from.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? We come from none, so it's like, we hungry more than you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Y'all over here, you know what I mean, chilling in, got a little nice crib, and y'all don't really want the position. Y'all just want the clout with
y'all just want the name behind it.
They want the little shine on the light, but when it comes down to the work, he was putting in the work that it required. So they was like, we gotta go with him. Like, he know the he know what he's talking about. He know what he's doing. So it's like
they went to an outside resource.
Yeah.
Because the inside resources wasn't going to be beneficial. Facts.
Exactly.
Facts.
And I would say when I came in, I was the only minority male African-American black coming in.
Okay.
You know, saying, so that's why we talking right now on the Vibeship TV right now. Is because at the end of the day, like I said, in the beginning, bro, there's not many black men that's in this position. You feel me?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, we talking about this is Black Wall Street year, probably a couple of them back then. Yeah. But now in this day and time, you hear somebody just tell when you said that to us at the event, you an architect. Hold on, we got pause. Right. You know what I'm saying? Nobody don't just say that. Like, yeah, you know I mean, yeah, it's like you putting together structures for the bricklayers, bro. Mm-hmm.
Right.
You feel me? That's like dope as hell to me. It's like, because at one point in time when I used to build Lego blocks too, bro, I used to think about being an architect. But I used to be like, you know what I'm saying? But that's just the mentality because how we raised, we doubt ourselves.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I doubted, like, man, I ain't even probably going to do that shit. You know what I'm saying? See, I yeah, got I mean, that's not what I'm going
to
be doing.
I got to where he was at. I got to where I could have basically said, you know, I'm going to stop going. I'm going to do something else. Or what you did, you ended up switching over doing night classes, bro. I stopped going.
Mm. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I used to do, had the internship at Turner's Construction Company.
Okay.
Got a grant from them and everything. But my pops got on the phone with me. He was like, there's two things you could do. Either you could switch out of it, do something else.
Mm-hmm.
He said, or he was like, you can start working and do something else. He's like, but it's your decision. I'm like,
he was in it too.
I looked over like, damn, I was thinking multimedia. I was like, I could do multimedia. This is before anybody was really doing it.
What school did you go to?
PTI.
Okay.
But it was PTI before it was PTC.
Right, right. Was it downtown?
Nah, Oakdale.
Oh, it's in Oakdale.
Bro, I was driving out. Bro, I mean, not driving. Okay. I was catching a bus out there. Me and my brother, Ro, he went right after me because he went the year after me. But he ended up staying for, I think, like a year or two.
Okay.
But I ended up just cramming out like, yeah, I'm not going to do it. I think I was working at McDonald's getting $7 and I was paying myself out. And I was just like, I ain't making enough for me to even pay for me to even be here. I'm like,
right.
Maybe I don't need to be here. Like he said, I didn't fully think the whole plan. But my dad definitely, like I said, he gave me that ultimatum. Like, you could stay up here.
Right.
He's like, but it got to be, he's like, got to be your decision. Like,
yeah.
Right.
And I was just like, nah, I ain't. And it's crazy to hear that and then to see the pivot of what you ended up doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like you said, bro, like, it's not a lot. I only know one other architect and I forget what her name was, and she made the August Wilson Center.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I got to see the blueprint for that, which was crazy. That shit was bananas, bro.
Right, right.
I was like, wow. I was like, so they're working for you? She was like, yeah. She was like, I put everything together. They do my revisions and everything. I'm like, oh, shit.
Okay.
Bro, super dope, bro.
Yeah, that's sweet.
You know what I'm saying?
That's crazy, though, yo. That's why I fuck with this. Like, you don't meet too many architects.
Right, bro.
You know what I'm saying? I ain't never really met an architect, you know what I'm saying? I'd be saying that because it's like my dream goal is definitely to get my home built from the ground up.
Yeah.
And he told me who you was working with, you know what I mean, with to get that happening and done, but it's like 280,000, you know what I'm saying, to get a house built from the ground up. Mm-hmm. You mainly just paying for the materials once you got the land.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Paying for the permits.
The costs are stacking up once you factor everything that goes into it, you know?
But I looked at the price and I was like, this is way cheaper than to go back crib. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, bro, why would I go through that when I can have it officially?
And be the first person.
I wanted
be the first person to christen it.
From head to toe. You know, well, yeah, I mean, nobody never lived in it. Yeah, I mean, it's yours. Like, you know what I'm saying? Your peoples will be living in here. Like,
yeah, because I would say, when you go buy a house, like, you know what I mean? You're still gonna want to do stuff that you want to do to it personally. It's
still
not gonna be
renovate.
Exactly how you want it to be. So it's like, you know, why not make your home, your dream home, all the way around from the ground up of what you wanted to be, you know, all the way around.
So how you feel about people? You know, that's a question that I wanted to ask. So how would you feel about people that buy homes and they be so excited? You know what I mean, I don't doubt. I ain't trying to down nobody. They be like, oh yeah, I got my new crib. You like, well, that's cool and all, but do you really know? You know what I'm saying? Like, how do you feel when you see somebody excited about that part?
How I feel about that, I congratulate them. You know, it's definitely an accomplishment of taking that step and actually, you know, putting your savings or, you know, whatever you had put to the side in order to get to purchase that home.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, it's an investment. You know, now you got equity. Now you got something, you know, back into you, you know, to, you know, pull out of, you know, things like that. Lastly, you are going to want to do personally things to that home as far as, like, if it's the kitchen, you don't, like, you might want to renovate the kitchen or, like, the bathrooms or, like, if you got kids, maybe your kids' rooms, things like that.
Want to bring more value to it.
Exactly, mm-hmm. Exactly. Okay. So for some people that are less fortunate, that process may take, you know, years of time. You know, they might not got money to, you know, put into the house immediately in order for them to get, you know, what they want out of it. You know, I would use my mom as a great example. You know, she bought her house in Penn Hills, you know, for, say, $120,000 at the time. Or no, I lied. Say it was like 60K or something like okay. that. Mm-hmm. And over the time, you know, she put into it, you know, redid the kitchen. She put a new deck in there, redid the bathrooms, you know, between her and my dad, not just my mother. Before she sold the house, it appraised at, say, like 150 or 160 grand, you know, she purchased it at, you know, 50-60% less than that.
So basically almost double to triple
right, the value. Right. But it took time in order to, you know, get to the point where the house was appraised at a higher amount. So I would say, you know, buying a house right now, for the people, I would definitely suggest them to make sure they're buying a house in a great market where, you know, you're not getting overcharged for the home. And definitely value what you like in the home, and definitely put to your mind of what you may want to change in the home, and also factor in the long term stability of you moving forward with the purchase you make.
Mm. So is it cheaper to get your house pretty much built from the ground up versus buying?
It depends on the area. Yeah. I said it depends on the area.
That's exactly what it said when I looked it up on Google.
Yeah,
it said depending on what state you're in. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Definitely the area, depending on the taxes and all the little laws where it's at.
Mm. Right.
You know, it's cheaper always to go out far, but it depends on how far you want to go.
Yeah. Right, right.
You know what I'm saying? Exactly. It's like, because out of rail, you know, further out in PA, there's homes in the cut. Mm-hmm. Big as hell. You're like, all right, they ain't too far from the city, like, but they far enough.
Like a high 30, 40.
I'm going to say a little past Monroeville.
Yeah, high 30, 40.
Like that. You're like, all right, this is the boonies, like, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, it's like
I think it's called
land,
like Extort or something like
land out that way. Like,
mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I'm saying? You're like, I'll just go get a patch of little land, build my home from the ground up, you know what I'm saying? But it's like, that would be your personal keeper. You know what I'm saying? Unless somebody want to build a big ass Walmart there, you like, I'm taking that check.
Right.
Yeah, I can't add this shit. Like, yo, yeah, I built it, but shit, nigga, y'all about to, yeah, because they going to pay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
I said, that's what happened to Master P. He said, buy some land in Africa. They wanted to build a mall, that motherfucker. He's like, they paid you out right. He's like, cancer disgust.
Oh, man.
You know what I mean? That's
easy to do that.
That's like 10 years later. Like, you know what I mean? You're like, oh.
That's real. You want to build a mall? You got it? He says, you got it?
We'll discuss the details later. You can buy that. Yeah, you can buy that thing.
Because
you're going to see some. That's the thing. Like, land is always going to make money.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, people died over this back then. Yeah, people died over this land, literally. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, over this land. So, like, how they play now is like, I just believe, like, in real estate, you know what I mean? Even you developing those projects is like, that's like the most important part.
Right.
Because it's like, before that building touched them streets, somebody got to design this the right way to make sure that when you put this together, there was a building in San Diego that's on a lien. Cause they didn't build down into the, what they call it, the cradle rock.
Oh, they ain't put it down deep enough.
They ain't put it down deep enough. They put a marble on the floor, that joint rolled.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it is like, oh, y'all done paid all this money for this crib? Woo! Never know what's gonna happen. There's earthquakes around here, bro.
Exactly.
I mean, you'll be in the wrong place at the wrong time. You gotta get the fuck up out of here now. Like, cause that's some real shit, like, but it's like somebody was, whoever built that, whoever constructed the architecture, didn't, you know what I'm saying?
They didn't put thought
or somebody was being lazy or something.
Correct.
Like, didn't want to do it. It's like, and what you're doing, you got to be on point and precise.
Exactly.
So that's deep, like, you know what I mean? You, from the beginning, you got to be on point, because when you give it to them, they got to know for sure, like, you sure, when we build this, it ain't going, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because they, you know what I mean, the workers are just the workers.
Exactly.
They just do their little parts.
When, on the side of the work that you do, I ask is because I know my sister's an architect, and I know she was going for a master's, and I know she had to, you know, when you first build a structure, do they actually build the desk models, like the 3D models, to where like you standing and looking at them on the table before they like start the actual construction and breaking ground? And
you mean like the blueprint?
It's like the 3D blueprint models,
yeah,
or 3D.
Is it like 3D, a computer?
Yeah,
or
like it would be like a so like this whole table would be like if it's a strip mall, they wanted to build a, you know, a strip mall, they would have a whole model of the table right here.
They'd be having
that. Oh, you're talking about through the augmented reality glasses.
Yeah.
Okay. I say some firms are more advanced where they are doing them type of things, but I would say here in Pittsburgh, a lot of firms are still in a 2D phase, so they're not even in 3D yet.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah.
They still behind.
Right, right, and, that, and that's a lot of the older firms. They don't want to adapt to the new immersive, innovative technology. I would say.
Do you feel like they'll die off by that?
You feel like it moves more faster, like it's more advanced when it comes to that.
Yeah, I say the 3D aspect of building a building. You know, you can basically get all the kinks out before the building's built. You know, so when you're doing things in 2D on flat piece of plan, a piece of paper. You're not really seeing, you know,
the full effect.
Yeah, you're not seeing, like, you know, exactly the height of the walls, or if I'm a MEP engineer drawing duct and stuff like that, I'm not seeing where the duct has risers at and could be crossing past electrical conduit and things like that. Mm-hmm. You know, when stuff is flat on paper, they're more so coordinating flatly. So
they're doing like layers.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So when them guys get in the field to actually build it, they're doing a lot of rework, and a lot of revisions are being made in the field because a lot of this stuff wasn't taken care of on the pre-construction set.
That's so true, because I was definitely on, they just did these buildings right in Oakland, right next to the CVS. If
I know CVS.
There now. I was actually doing,
because they redid the Orbeez, didn't they?
Yeah.
They ended up making a new Orbeez.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
And
yeah.
I was roofing, still like a solid roofer at that time, but like, I could hear the guys in there saying, like, okay, they had been, like you said, reworked, like, because, like, stuff wasn't, like, on, like, adding up, you know what I mean?
And that's
like,
what I'm saying, they got to be on point. Yeah,
they wasn't on point at all, so they had to, like you said, rework stuff.
Revisions.
To make it. How they want it.
Revisions,
you know,
is,
I
mean, irritating,
yeah,
bro.
That's right. Crazy. Like, yeah, man. It's like fucking up you know, so crazy. You know, to remind me of, because what he's doing, an architect, is numbers, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when I used to be in the accounting class, the same shit, bro. Fuck up one number.
Everything's,
oh, God. Up. You'd be like, yo, what the? Hold up. What? You know what I'm saying? You got to retract the whole thing, because the balance sheet got to. It got to even out at the bottom. So it's like, that's just fucked up. You know what I'm saying? You got to find out where or what number was in there wrong. Like, right, so it's right. like the systems they use now is much more easier. You know what I'm saying? But I, like, back then, they say cooking the books. I can believe Joe was cooking the books because, you know what I'm saying? Like, human error. Like, like, you know what I mean? You got somebody writing down all these numbers, like, you know what I mean? Keeping track of all these assets in this business. Like, that's crazy. And that's the same thing, like, they keeping track of all the numbers, you know what I mean, being precise with the measurements. They got to be on point.
Right, right.
It's like, so you got your own business now.
Right. Before I go in there, I want to kind of rewind it back.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I know we kind of get off track just a little bit, but it's all right. We have a good conversation. In my role at Michael Baker, I was a BIM manager there, like I said. I learned a lot from the guy who was, you know, kind of on top of me. You know, so he was teaching me, giving me different books and magazines to look after, and different immersive technologies that was coming out to stay on top of that I could possibly present to the company.
Mm.
So it was more like a technical role where I was learning technology, you know. And at that point in time, I'm like, damn, I love technology. Like, this is cool. Perfect. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's innovative. It makes jobs easier. It's more, you know, automative, you know, so it's not, it cuts out a lot of repetitive tasks. I would say so. Technology is definitely the thing.
Yeah.
So moving through that that role at Michael Baker International, I would say, like I said, a lot of internal staff that were already working for the company didn't like that I was in the role that I was in. So I think they was like putting bugs in the upper hire manager's ear. Like I said, I'm around back. I was like one of the only black people that worked there.
Right.
You know, there wasn't no more blacks. Yeah. So I will never forget this day. One of the day I went into work, I had to be there at 9 o'clock. I probably got there at 9:04. My bigger boss pulled me to his office. He said, yeah, hey, I'm not sure what's going on. Guys are saying that you're slipping on projects and this and that. Like, just making up stuff. I'm like,
wow.
Because as the BIM manager, people come to you with questions. So people who's kind of like far back on technology or using like the programs we were using, they would come ask me questions and I would walk them through, you know, as a teacher. So everybody internally, you know, with me working with them, they love me. Like, I never had no problem with any of this stuff.
Right.
But, you know, this day I walked in, it was just, you know, all these problems out of nowhere. I'm like, this can't be right. So at the end of the conversation, it was like, you know, Taekwon. It's your last day.
Damn.
Wow.
That's straight fucked up.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So I'll never forget. I left from there. I called my girlfriend. I'm like, damn. I'm like, babe, they just fired me. Like,
so they didn't even give you no warning or nothing?
They didn't give me no warning. But I was already telling her. I was already talking to her like a week before. I'm like, it don't feel right. Like, I kind of already knew it was coming. Shaky. Yeah, right. Because it was always just something that they was, like, they was complaining about the littlest stuff. Yeah. Like, the littlest stuff.
Superman.
And just think, like, I came from a position that didn't manage, you know, all the team players into a position I managed all the team players, and I was, you know, doing great at it, but they still picked out the littlest things that, you know, I probably wasn't doing the best, and threw it back at me as like a negative to, you know, playing that role for the company. You know, so basically they clicked all the little things and said, hey, I don't think you're the best fit for this position. Yeah. So I'm
pure hate.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It was just them hating hard. You know what I'm saying? That's just jaws me. That's the drive, the entrepreneurship right there.
Yeah. Right.
Anytime that shit happened to me too, like on some fluid shit, like, I'm not with that shit no more.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Even with Lay, same thing. It's like, bro, when it happened, only a few, you know what I'm saying, it do that to you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, no, I can't find my own. I can't be with this shit no more. You know what I'm saying? I gotta use y'all. You know what I'm saying? I can't be like, yeah, man, because it's like, you just know what it is. It's just like corporate America's, you know what I mean, choosing to spit people out all the time. Right. They even spit their own kind out like that. So it's like,
where they try to make it seem like they want you to be the best, and then once you become the best, it's like, you're unstoppable now. Now they don't know what to do with you.
Yeah.
That's what be wild about it. It'd be like, y'all setting me up. Mm-hmm. You think y'all set me up for failure, but you're actually helping me out without even knowing it. Because you just basically stated to me that I surpassed you guys.
Right.
And I'm doing a better job than you guys. So because of that, you guys are terrified and scared. So it's like, for real, bro. Like, I done seen it so many times, bro. Like, when it comes to management jobs, people would be like, yeah, I'm going to make you assistant manager. And then that turns into you getting fired. Or it be on some, you do great at your job, we're going to push you up ahead. And then they end up sticking you in the same spot for 6 more months.
That's what that's how I was with TRG, bro. They wanted to, you know, I was doing well. And it was like, I had a record. I still got a record. But they was like, because I was supposed to get off the phone like kind of like a mentor and you know, help people, you know,
but wasn't trying to pay you not an extra fucking dime.
Bro, they wasn't
they wasn't trying to pay you an extra fucking dime. That's what make it even wilder.
Like the people there, they wanted me in that next level, but the higher ups wouldn't let them put me.
Talking about like Santos.
Yeah. No, not even Santos, because Santos, he was on me.
So above Santos. There,
but like, yeah, above Santos. Okay. Like,
Finelli, whatever dude's name is.
Yeah.
I remember he was back
he
there.
He wanted me in that position. I'm like, this is crazy, bro. But I mean, I was, you know.
But they had Shrek in that position.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
He was a whole trip.
Who's the other guy?
The whole trip.
Who's another guy with glasses too? They's kind of they is all like kind of around. They like to pick and choose for. But it seemed like I said, they like to paint us as the monster.
Right.
But it's just like, are y'all mad because y'all couldn't do it faster, or because I did it faster than y'all?
Exactly.
So like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
so was that the drive after that? To make you into your own business owner?
For you to push yourself?
There's something else that happened after that. But I will say, for that company, the pros that I got out of it, you know what I mean? I met a good employee that I still talk to this day.
Okay.
That definitely looked out for me and gave me tips and tricks and things like that. And also, I got a new car out of it. Like, that company had, like, an internal credit union where they didn't they didn't base your I say, you know how you go get a car, they base off your credit.
Yeah.
It was based off the income I was making at that job. So
okay.
Yeah. So they just took my
pay
stuff.
Special deal with the company.
Yeah. So I said, that's the pros.
That's all. Yeah, that's definitely the pros.
Yeah. So transitioning out of that, I went to apply for some more jobs. I did like some a lot of different I say interviews. I was the interview king, man. I promise you, every single interview I ever went on, they wanted me. Exactly. So this next round of interviews I went on, I probably interviewed for like 4 companies. The one company that I chose to work for, it's called AECOM. AECOM's the number 2 engineering firm in the world.
Okay.
So they was behind Jacobs Engineering, which I was working for, you know, prior to Michael Baker. For this new position I was working for with AECOM was I was the scan the bill manager. So scan the BIM was like an emerging technology that came out. At the time, I didn't really know anything too much about it. I knew about it, but I never knew how it worked. I was introduced to it at Michael Baker, but I never worked with it. So
like hands-on?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So this could give a quick definition of what scanning the bilma is. Scanning the bilma is basically, so nowadays, not nowadays, but in the old days, and still to today, some firms, they go out to these larger buildings that they're renovating. So say, for example, this building that we're in right now, it's all office spaces. But say, you know, one day they wanted to make it into residential. Somebody would have to come in here and measure this building in order to get the existing plans for this building in order to, you know, convert it to residential. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So they'll send a guy in here with a measuring tape. So this guy will have a measuring tape, and it could take, for a building this size, it probably take like over a month or something.
Because he got to measure everything.
Every single thing. I mean, from the walls to the ceiling heights to all the different furniture in here, the soffits, like a lot of everything needs measured.
You might get sleepy and fuck something.
Said, you sure that was 2.2, man?
I bet you know. I just think it was 3, 4, 5.
Exactly.
Damn.
That's why that system had to get in play. Like, he done, woo.
Exactly. So,
Jim done, fuck that, damn it. I thought you said it was right. I thought I heard it. Fire,
right. That's exactly what was happening.
There's too many of that shit going on. Oh, that old school way would have been vicious.
Right. Ooh, so just to transform to what we use nowadays is reality capture technology. So what reality capture is, we got these 3D laser scanners. So what a 3D laser scanner is, it's the device. It's not a cheap piece of equipment. You can get cheaper ones, but it doesn't give you the most precise point. So the,
what's the price range on them?
So you can go as cheap as like 15 grand, but for the good ones that we was using, it was in between like 60 and 70 grand. Yeah.
So how long would it take you to measure this building? Because like you said, it would take a month. So with that, how more productive would it be?
Okay, so with the reality capture equipment, for that price range of like 70 grand, so basically what it do is it's a tripod that's set up almost like a camera. It goes on top, and what it is, it's like it's a point cloud. So for the newer iPhone users, like 12 and up, there's something called LiDAR on your phone. So what LiDAR is, it basically produces like these point clouds. So this laser scan spins for like 2 minutes, and it's getting like millions and millions and millions of points of the room. Mm-hmm. It's getting it precise to like the 0.2 decimal. So it's not missing any type of, errors or anything like that. You know, it's getting the ceiling heights, it's getting the floor heights, it's getting all the wall dimensions, everything you need. You know,
as accurate as it can be.
Are they using that to look at cribs too?
So, because
it's like, you know how they shoot a 3D, and I can go in there and look around at the spot 3D. Like, is that
So what you're talking about is photogrammetry, and that's used with Matterport. Yeah, it's similar.
But it's built something technical instead of
right.
Yeah, okay.
Matterport actually did come out with a new scanner as well. It's their Matterport number 3 version that does have LiDAR connected to it. So it kind of does the same things, but it's still slower. And it doesn't give the most precise dimensions. So their accuracy is probably within like 4 inches or 5 inches.
It's for like a smaller scale.
Yeah, right. Okay. You wouldn't come through here with like a Matterport scanner or scan this whole entire building. So that's what scan the building is. And basically, we take the point cloud form and we put it into a software called Rivet. Rivet is like the industry standard of architectural software. And that's how we built like the 3D models and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So when you get the point cloud form, first you got to register it. It takes like a long little process. Back to your question, how long would it take to measure this building? Just to give or take, probably like a day. A day, yeah. Not 24 hours, more so like 4 to 6 hours. Yeah. Like a work day.
Yeah.
You need that. But that's so crazy. What's wild is though, all right, you're in the architect space. They got machines printing out 3D homes.
Right. Yeah, they got
big. Is that like y'all job market, basically?
So I haven't necessarily gotten into it.
When I've been seeing that going on, like, you know, you just scroll on Instagram, you'll see that going on. You're like, that nigga point printing the whole 3D crib. Shit is crazy. Like, you know what I mean? The machine's really printing the crib, but like how he said 4 hours, that shit printed up that crib, nigga, like in 24.
Shout out to the Chinese for that.
Like, they more immersive than doing technology. Some shit that that's unreal, bro. And it's like there's a company in America right now that he's doing that now. So it's like, now his, of course, that pricing like fucking crazy. You know what I'm saying? But eventually, it's going to be that's what's happening right now, bro.
Right.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, what's happening is technology. There's this form of technology that's innovative for a man to learn how to use at one point in time. Now it's being innovative, we're replacing man. You know what I'm saying? It was first for you to help you, like that tool to print the crib. Like, oh yeah, we need that. Okay, that can help us.
Right.
Now y'all got some shit that print the crib. Now what about me? You know what I'm saying? Like, what about me? You know what I'm saying? It's like, that's what the world's coming into. And that shit give me like a little bit of chills for the youngins, cause it's like, bro, where the fuck are they gonna work at?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, all right, now you gotta teach him how to invest. True. You gotta teach him how to do some shit that's different.
No, even that too. What I tell all the youngins is, I say, go get a degree in technology. So if it's like computer science or cybersecurity or anything to do with like coding or IT, you know, because even though, you know, we got this immersive technology coming out that's, you know, very innovative, that's like taking over jobs, you know, but there's always also need somebody to program these robots and stuff like that. So that's when, you know, the IT guys come in, or technical difficulties happen, or computer science guys come in who actually going to code this stuff, or even like the cybersecurity guys who has to protect all this information that's being spread around in the cloud virtually. So I would definitely give a tip like that out to the youngest.
They teaching my kids coding in school now.
Yeah.
Right.
That's what they're doing now, like, you know what I'm saying? But it's like, that's just another job market for them to prepare for. But it's still like learning technology is definitely key, because I like even investing in certain technologies. You said we living in the Matrix. You know what I'm saying? You got Elon Musk it's building robots. There, like you said he got a robot, huh? Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like, oh, so he gonna be in my crib, just get me plates of food and shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like, that's gonna be, this is where somebody said I watched some crazy shit. I was on the VR, right? And they had videos on the VR, and the VR was talking about this dude. He was like in some 1930s talking about technology now. He said, it was a wild conversation. I ain't gonna say the whole thing, but it was just like, he said, we'll be building technology, but technology would be stupid now. But what if to say that years later, that technology that we build turns on us? Mm-hmm. And those be aliens to us.
Matrix, bro.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, who's to say, that the advanced civilization that was here years ago, they built stuff and then it took over them.
Right.
Because at a certain point, it's like, all right, y'all play around with human consciousness and all this, and y'all playing around with robots. But y'all going to get this. That's like, I'm watching this thing called Descendant. I'm going to just say this last part because I ain't trying to be too long. But Descendant, they plugged his mind into the machine.
Come on, the movie.
Yeah, okay. With Johnny Depp back in the day.
Okay, yeah.
And then there he started the machine. They thought that he wasn't a soul. But when he gave the girl the technology, she said, I could feel the whole earth. He said, I was trying to heal the whole earth, but y'all thought I was trying to kill it and take it over. He said, when humans kill what they don't understand. He said, y'all poisoned the whole earth. He was showing her everything that we was doing to it. You know what I mean? Everything that the technology we was... Nanotechnology.
Right.
I'm saying that's like the highest technology I believe they got access to, but you know, that's another conversation.
Bro, they were saying, all right. Like, when I was saying with the Matrix, bro, they were saying this. Like, the true story, like, why it ended up being like how it was in the Matrix, there was a butler. The butler turned on his owner and he killed him.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, bro. That's like kind of like the origin of it. Like, they had it on Cartoon Network back in the day. So, that's like the origin of where it started at. And then the Matrix ended up happening. And then, as you can see later on, you see that the technology tried to kill them off every time they went into their software and their space and stuff. That's why.
Right.
Bro, this is what's happening down there right now. Elon Musk, he got these robots. They about to do all this wild shit.
Yeah.
I'm going to be ready.
Right, exactly. I just know when he said he was trying to move to Mars, I was like, oh, yeah, he taking them with him. Yeah, I'm saying, they going to be our helpers when this shit get down. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, that's what a human being does, bro. He's going to have to build some shit. They know what's out there. They just ain't going to tell niggas. You know what I'm saying? But whatever's out there, they got to build something to protect them. They already said they going to live in bubbles. Oh, yeah, large. That's infrastructure. My dad, a long time ago, bro, I lied to you now. He looked me dead in my eye. He said, a long time ago, there's a man that built bubbles on the moon. He said, he's going to build bubbles for Mars. This is years ago. And now it came to light. So I had to go do my research. They was already building them and testing them on Earth. They would live in the bubble, bro. The whole community. And he said to, and they programmed them emotionally with shit. Like, so they can operate as a society without the flaws of this society.
Right.
So, like, putting shit in them to make them act a certain way.
Right, right.
Like, y'all niggas is fucking with some other shit. Like, that reminds me of some scientific movie shit you like fucking with. Don't fuck with none of that. Like, but that's why I be like, movies be telling you what the fuck be going on. Oh, yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, so I just be like, yo, infrastructure like that, architects even go that far. It's right. Like, all right, if the planet was the end, he gone. We should you architect, bro, or we gonna need
about
you?
2050, bro. About 2050,
build some shit.
They're gonna be able to have at least a million people on Mars. Yeah. There'll be a million people living on Mars by 2050.
That's what they said.
That's just crazy.
That's super crazy.
Bro, that shit's wild. I heard that. That's 30 years. Like if years? That. What'd you say, bro?
How long would it take? Don't it take like 4 years to get to Mars?
No.
Technically?
Cause it take a couple months.
No,
take like 10 months.
Yeah.
Oh,
does
it?
Yeah. That's why they go there, cause it's close. Like, it ain't that far.
Yeah, bro.
You know what I'm saying, but you ain't.
And they get damn near got the same atmosphere that we got here.
Yeah. On certain parts, So like certain degrees is like a certain amount of oxygen.
So they're basically trying to just make slide it the second in. Earth. Yeah. So once this dies out, and they got all the people that they need over there,
yeah, they gonna do their thing.
Yeah, bro.
It'd be a new society.
Yeah.
Think imagine that shit. You like, yeah, I'm like,
we got 30 years, folks.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so I don't know what I was do. I don't know how I'm gonna feel about that. I just hope I ain't here when the shit all over.
Shit. it ain't gonna be over,
just imagine this shit falling apart. Like, yeah, I mean, you like this shit like the real movies. Like, right.
Just gonna be a
fuck?
Part of the transition.
You
bro.
Have to get your burners up, nigga. Like, you be out here on some off the grid.
Facts.
Oh man.
Like, yeah, I mean, he gonna have a shit in the cut. Like, yeah, I already built that.
Gonna call to AOT. Where you at, bro? I'm sliding up there right now in the rocket ship.
Like, yeah, I mean, yo, build this for me down here, real quick.
You ever seen an underground bunker like some like that?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, you built something like that?
No, I ain't building like
but
that.
But you seen somebody build some shit like that? Yeah. Oh, that's probably the hardest.
That's crazy.
Because it's like, yo, that's real. There's a whole bunch of them.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But that them right there, that's all around America.
Mm-hmm.
Whole lot of bunkers. Yeah, you know I mean, hitting shit that they don't want to tell you about.
Right, right, exactly.
So real quick, going off that real quick, the bunkers, is it the same method of how technology and stuff that you would use to build the underground bunker since it's underground and it's not technically like a structure?
Yeah. So there's like technology where like the LIDAR that I will take to come and scan this room, there's LIDAR that's like ground immersive where you can like see underground.
So you
kind of know like where to dig at and stuff like that. And I say anything with the ground is more like civil engineering.
Okay.
So they deal with like the contours and like surfaces and all stuff like that. So
Do archaeologists, I say that right, archaeologists.
Mm-hmm.
Archaeologists, do they use that type of stuff for underground?
Archaeologists?
Yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, because I know like watching the little history channels and stuff like that, they'll scan the ground to see like the structure under the ground.
Yeah, yeah. They more so test like different sites, I would say.
Yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So like now just the last part of this, you got your own business, right?
Correct.
So how many clients have you did in your whole business?
So I kind of didn't jump right into, you know, where I'm at right now. I say, so from AECOM, when I was working at AECOM as a scan and BIM manager there, I started working there like right before the pandemic. So when the pandemic hit, I got furloughed for like 3 months and they extended it for another 3 months. So I'm like a total of like 6 months furloughed.
Okay.
So at that time, I'm like, you know, I'm not a person that just want to sit on my ass and, you know, not do nothing with myself. So I start, you know, fishing around and just trying to, you know, use my skill set to, you know, I guess build my business. But at the time, I'm just trying to make a couple dollars. You know, I wasn't necessarily trying to build a business. You know what I mean? So AECOM basically said, you know, they're not bringing me back because I was working with a major client with them, which was Amazon. We was like doing like a lot of Amazon facilities.
Interest.
Right.
What they call it? I forgot the word for it. The word, they call it an accounting when you, I mean, a conflict of interest shit.
So yeah, we had a lot of contracts with Amazon. Then basically after the pandemic, a lot of them contracts you know, didn't come back. So it was like a new group of the company. I say like a new section of the company I started. I was like one out of like three guys. The other two guys were like a lot older than me, like in the 50s. I was the only younger guy coming in, so I was like the last man out. So it was more so like, you know, we're going to pay you for the 6 months of you, you know, not being here. But after the 6 months is up, you know, you're not coming back. Yeah, so from there, that's kind of when I like jump started my own company. You know what I mean? So I got my LLC made. I started, you know, built my business credit. Like I'm real, real big with credit, personal and business wise. So I started getting that all structured and stuff like that. So I kind of already knew how to, you know, get things started on the front end, just because I was a, you know, I'm an intelligent guy when it comes to stuff like that, you know, on the business side.
You already had the ball rolling.
Right, yeah. Exactly. So, you know, I might know, like, the technical side and stuff like that and how to do the work, but the administration side, that's what really, you know, builds your brand and, you know, keeps you moving, because you need to stay organized and,
right,
in order to, you know, strive and do what you want to do in life and not just, you know, a business of itself. Right. So, you know, starting off, I say one of the first guys I got linked up with was Mitch Poe. You know what I mean? Shout out to Mitch Poe.
Right, Poe Effect.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So Mitch Poe, that's my guy. You know what I mean? So we did a lot of cribs together. He got me a lot of clients of himself. And I was just, you know, going, just doing residential.
Yeah, balls up like, from
yeah,
there.
Right. Yeah, it was just all residential. Then from there, I'm like, okay, like I'm making a little bit of money right now, but it's, you know, it's coming and going because it's not, you know, a lot of big chunks. And it wasn't like I was having, you know, a lot of repetitive clients. It was like a lot of one-off clients, you know.
Okay. Yeah. I see what you mean.
Right. So somebody might want their house designed, like, all right, that's cool. But they might not have another house for like another 6 months or so. Might be opening up like a beauty salon or like a barbershop or something like that. I will go do the tenant fit out for that and design that layout for them and get that submitted to the city as far as like permit wise. And just remind back a little bit, when I first started, I didn't know a lot about like coding and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So me myself, I'm not a registered architect like that, actually stamp and license prints and stuff like that. So I had to partner with a licensed architect, and that's where I started to learn how to, you know, read like the code book. So at the time we was using the IBC 2015, the IEBC 2015. So IBC is the International Building Code. The IEBC is the International Existing Building Code. So those are two different codes that you got to put in conjunction in order to make sure, you know, a building is being you know, designed up to standards. Yeah. So
that's, they always update them too.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So right now we're on 2018. So we're always like a few years behind of the actual physical year, you know, that we're working with. So that's a lot of learning that I had to do, because a lot of the clients that I was getting was like small, just commercial clients. That one, like I said, one like Raymond Edmonds. I'm sure if you guys know Raymond Edmonds. He's a real, real big bodybuilder. I just got them designing this gym maybe like a year ago in the South Side.
Okay.
So he came to me with, it was actually Miss Poe's, from, like I said, Miss Poe, being one of a lot of guys. Like it was Miss Poe's guy. But a lot of these guys came to me needing to get occupancy for their building. So that was kind of like my initiative as far as like services I provide. Like I was, people would come to me with a problem, and I was providing the basic
solution
to solve the problem. Mm-hmm. You know, so I was doing like a lot of occupancy permits and things like that. But I more so got, I wouldn't necessarily say burnt out, but it was more like a hassle of the guy who I was partnered with and working in conjunction with. He was kind of getting like a little bit jealous that I was getting all these clients, and
you was building relationships.
Yeah, yeah, I wasn't building relationships, and he's the one stamping them. Yeah, he's like, dang, like, you know your stuff, but I know he's thinking like, dang, like, I wish I was getting all these clients on my own. Like, how are you meeting all these people? But these people look like me. They don't know new architects to go to, you know. Right. So when somebody think of an architect, they think of, you know, me, myself. Yeah. So that's kind of how I was building my relationships in, like, the residential industry and in a small, mid-sized commercial industry. But like I said, I kind of got burnt out off that work, you know, of just, you know, going back to him as a hassle to be able to stamp my plans. So I met like a major mentor that I still talk to this day. Like, it's like my current mentor. He's actually like a Greek guy. Like, he's real cool. He's from Jersey. He still lives in Jersey. But I met him when I was briefly at Michael Baker. He came into the office literally one day. I forget what our conversation was, but later down the line, like fast forward to after I got furloughed and released from AECOM, I met him again on like LinkedIn. I like reached out to him. Then we had like a conversation. He was working with at this company at the time, and you know, I let him know what I was trying to do. And basically, he got me partnered up with like a major firm who was actually like, you know, wanted to provide the same services as me. Mm-hmm. So instead of like me just, you know, focuses on like architecture solely, I more so went from just a standard architectural mindset and more so transitioned to like an architectural technology mindset. So I went back to like my CAD degree when I knew how to, you know, do like a lot of 3D stuff and like architectural and just structural and mechanical plumbing and all that stuff needs to get, you know, built from a pre-construction phase. And these plants don't need stamp. You know, you just need to build the 3D model and be able to coordinate the 3D model.
Because everybody else is going to code it for you.
Right, right. Exactly. Exactly. So he got me partnered up with a company in New Jersey at the time. And with this New Jersey company, you know, I'm talking to these guys, I'm talking to the owner of the company, and we're just building a relationship. Like, you know, there's a lot of projects out here. Just to fast forward, I mean, to rewind back a little bit in the administration process when I was getting my business set up, there's something called an MBE. Your MBE is your Minority Business Enterprise. That's a certification that you have for your company. Mm. So for a lot of these major projects out here, there needs to be 15% allocated to minority business enterprises for, you know, every single major project. And usually, contracts usually go to like people like contractors and electricians, things like that, people who's like in the physical labor role. Right. But you don't see any engineering firms or like firms like me who know how to do what I do, like, not do with facts. Technology, oh, who's facts. Getting them type of contracts. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I like, you know, curve my way in the game. So, you know, I'm networking with the guy that I met in Jersey. Did. Yeah, exactly. So I'm networking and talking to the guy, and so he's like, yeah, there's a lot of projects coming here in Pittsburgh. I would give one example, like the Pittsburgh International Airport. So like my curve that I went for that type of contract is that prior before that, there was like a class that I was going to at RCI. So RCI is the Riverside Innovation Center on the north side. So they got like a lot of resources there as far as like entrepreneurism. They show you like contracts coming up. Like it's for to basically help like new level entrepreneurs get into the game. So one of their classes there was for the airport. It was basically getting in on the minority side and like the contracts they was going to be offering and things like that. So that's kind of like how I knew about, you know, them offering contracts for the airport. And while I was there, I got connected to the diversity lady who was in charge of the airport and giving out them type of contracts. So yeah, so when I got in contact with her, I got on her email list and she was emailing me. So there's like different tiers when it comes to these major type of contracts. So there's a prime contractor. A prime contractor may be like the GC or let's say like the construction manager of the whole entire job. So like a Turner Construction or like a PJ Dick or something like that, like a major player who owns the entire job. Then like the tier two, tier three, them are the people who's contracted under the major contractor, you know. So I got like the email list of all the primes that was going to be bidding for that job, you know. So I started doing my homework.
So you was already on top tier.
Yeah, right. So I started doing my footwork. So you know me, just on the back office side, I put together like a portfolio of, you know, my overview history, you know, of my business, when I got founded, the services I provide, different projects I already had worked on, you know, things of the sort like that. So I emailed this, prior to like 40 different firms that was bidding for that job. And what I got one hit on one of the firms that actually won. So during the bidding process, I didn't put in, like I say, like the correct number bid, like my number was kind of too high. But they kind of wanted to work with me. So after they won the product, they came back to me and said, like, hey, like, you know, can you kind of alter this number? Can we, like, you know, we want to work with you. So that went on for like a good couple of weeks or so like that. So we finally came up with a number, and that's when I got my first six-figure contract with the Pittsburgh International Airport and the lead GC on the project.
On fire, man. Y'all hear this, man? He giving out game, you know what I'm saying? giving out game. Telling you, that's crazy. That's how you worked your way in, bro. It's like, you know what I'm saying? You just, the thing about it is, like, you just learned the skills. You know what I'm saying? You ain't complaining about the process of learning the skills.
Right.
Skills is the key. know what I'm saying? But you knew how to get the skill and utilize the skill to get in front of the right motherfuckers. He's like, oh, I'm about to use, you know what I'm saying, use this to do this. I know how to, you know what I'm saying? Hey, that's the thing. A lot of people got skills, but they don't know how to develop them.
Right.
I was just talking about this, you know what I'm saying, for some content for that I made for this next week. It was like, that's, a lot of people don't got the data. They got the, everybody got something good with them, but they got to develop it.
Right.
I mean, you was developing the skill from all the information in the game you just gave, bro. It was just like, you worked and learned. Like, I went to this school. Then I learned this. I got set back doing this. Then I did this. You know what I'm saying? Then I worked my way in this business. You know what I'm saying? Then they got rid of me. Then I went to this. And you know what I mean? Then I got a mentor. Like, he was, you know what I mean? Yeah, you know I mean? Just kept always moving. You never stayed in that one place. You're like, I'm going up, bro. No matter what.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, and then now you negotiated a six-figure contract for the airport.
Right, exactly. And this is for the this is for the garage side. So they're building a new garage, which is going to be like 2 million square feet. On a garage, it's going to connect to like the main terminal. So right now, with the same GC that I got the contract with, we're negotiating a second contract for me to actually do some work on the terminal set. Like that's where the main real money's at.
Since you started your personal business, would you say this is the biggest like kind of contract you had?
Hell yeah. So
and this is a contract for your business.
Exactly. This is strictly for me.
That's
exactly.
Again. Yeah, I'm saying because that's real, bro. It's like, yeah, I mean, you negotiated a huge contract for your own company, your own business, like. Not under nobody else's stamping your shit, and you ain't gotta. You went through your own way,
right?
You found that way. That's the dopest shit, bro. It's like that's hard, bro.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That's some real. That's a vibe, bro.
I appreciate that.
You know what I'm saying? You gave us a real. You gave us the game, bro. It's like, you know what I mean, becoming an architect, building your own business, and going through your trials and tribulations. I'm just letting anybody out there know, like, you can do it too. That's the place you want to go. You know what I'm saying? You could do it too.
Right.
I'm saying before we get up out of here, though, you know what I'm saying, I want you to like tell somebody young that's pursuing that, that's thinking about that.
Okay.
What would you say to them right now?
So somebody younger in the generation, what I would say to them right now is basically, you know, if you're somebody who likes technology, likes to use your hands, things like that, look into, you know, different programs that may be in your high school. So there are programs in your high school, like CAD courses, that can get you the introduction to, you know, being an architect or somebody in architectural technology or like a BIM manager. BIM, when I say BIM, I mean building information modeling. So if you guys want to look that up, that's basically all the technology I use in order to, you know, build these three 3D structures and things like that virtually prior to the buildings being built. So I would tell somebody young, you know, to, you know, do like their footwork, get into these courses and things like that, and see, you know, if there's something that they like, if there's something that they like, then go on and move forward to like find like a college, you know, that they can possibly go to and develop their skills a lot farther in order to, you know, for them to fully get into the industry, I would say. And I will also say, it's not currently out yet, but I'm starting a nonprofit organization as well. That's going to teach tech for kids, all the strategies that I learned coming up as far as modeling and using the 3D scanners, drones, you know, everything technology-wise that plays a role in construction. I'm creating a nonprofit organization to bring kids into a training center that will be opened up soonly in order to teach them and mold them and make sure, you know, that they see something differently. Like I said, when I came up with as a kid through high school and things like that, I didn't know anything about, you know, the industry I'm in right now. If this was probably brought to me at a younger age, then maybe I had a different trajectory of, you know, where I want to go as far as, you know, success. Do I want to play in the NFL or do I want to do this? It was more so I was just tunnel vision of playing sports. So I would say it's not just sports out here or being a rapper or an entertainer, things like that. There are real careers and that deal with technology that can take you farther and get you paid how you want to get paid.
My man, you just laid it on y'all, man. The architect. Definitely. You know what I'm saying?
Thanks for having me. I appreciate that.
Appreciate you coming through, bro. For real.
Vibeship TV. It's a vibe.